In the last video, we studied how quickly the Fourier series for a periodic function converged. Now we're going to go back to the question of a Fourier series using sine functions. That is, for a function that is zero at the two ends of an interval, we do a Fourier series using sine functions, how quickly does that converge? So let's suppose we have a function on the interval 0 to L, and the two ends are tacked down. F of 0 and F of L are both 0. And we want to expand that as a sum of sine functions, sum of cn sine n pi x over L. Okay. So the basic question is, how quickly does cn go to 0 as n goes to infinity? Or in other words, how many terms are we going to need to get a good approximation to f? And our strategy for studying this is turning it into a problem for periodic functions. We're going to define a new periodic function, f twiddle of x, that extends f. And then we're going to compute the periodic Fourier series of f twiddle. And we're going to realize that the sine Fourier series of f is very, very closely to the periodic Fourier series of f twiddle. And then we're going to use what we learned about periodic Fourier series in the last video, apply it to f twiddle, and interpret the results for f. So here's the procedure. If you give me any old function on the interval from 0 to L, I'm going to extend it to a periodic function as follows. The first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to take the mirror image. So I'm going to define f at a point between negative L and 0 to be minus f of the corresponding point here. So if we've got a big hump over here near L, we're going to have a big negative hump near minus L. If it's small near 0, you're going to be small on the negative side of 0. And when you do this, the first derivative extends smoothly. If this behaves like a constant times x on one side, it behaves like the same constant times x on the other side. And then you see that what's happening over here near L is matched by what's happening here near minus L. So you just repeat the function. And now we've got ourselves a periodic function, but it's not periodic with period L, it's periodic with period 2L. What's happening in negative 2L and at 0 and at 2L is the same. What's happening at minus L and at L and at 3L is the same. So we've got our new periodic function, and we know how to decompose periodic functions. We can write a periodic function as a constant plus a sum of cosines and sines. And the cosines and sines involve multiples of 2 pi x over the period. But in this case, the period isn't L, it's 2L. So the 2 from the 2 pi and the 2 from the 2L actually cancel. And so we wind up with cosines and sines of n pi x over L. Okay, next we want to figure out what the coefficients an and bn are. We know how to do that. We have to get an, we have to integrate over one period, 2 divided by the period, cosine of n of 2n pi x over 2l times f twiddle dx. And I'm going to pick the period, instead of integrating from 0 to 2l, I'm going to integrate from negative l to l. It's still one period. Now we have a cosine times f twiddle. But the cosine is an even function. If you take x or minus x, you get the same value. F twiddle is an odd function. The way we constructed it is its value at minus x was minus the value at x. Minus x gives you minus what you have at x. So you have an even function times an odd function integrated over an even interval. That gives you 0. Whatever this integral picks up from 0 to L is exactly canceled by whatever it gets between minus L and 0. So there are no cosine terms. As for bn, 2 over 2L integral of sine times f twiddle. And now this is odd and this is odd, so the product is even. And that means that whatever you get from negative L to 0 is exactly matched by what you get from 0 to L. So you can just multiply through by 2 and only integrate from 0 to L. And so the BN for this periodic Fourier series is given by this integral, which is exactly the integral for the CN for the sine Fourier series. So if you want to understand how fast the CNs decay, you just have to look at how fast the BNs decay. And that's essentially the same thing as the decay rate of F twiddle hat. And we know how fast that is. That has to do with how many times is F twiddle differentiable. So let's look at some examples. First example is we have the function L equals 1, and we have the function, a parabola, x times 1 minus x. Okay. Well, we have to extend that by mirroring it on the other side between negative 1 and 0. So we take a new function, which is the same as the old function between 0 and 1, and is its mirror image between 0 and negative 1, and then we extend it with period 2. So this goes over here, this goes over here, and so on. Now this looks pretty good. Looks like just a sine wave to begin with, but it's not quite. If you take its derivative, the derivative of x times 1 minus x is 1 minus 2x. The derivative of x times 1 plus x is 1 plus 2x. So the derivative looks like 1 plus 2x between negative 1 and 0, and 1 minus 2x between 0 and 1, and then it repeats between, what it does between 1 and 2 is the same as what it did between negative 1 and 0. What it does between negative 2 and negative 1 is the same thing as between 0 and 1. So the derivative is this sawtooth. It's continuous, but the second derivative isn't. When we take the derivative of this, we get that our second derivative is negative 2 between 0 and 1, and then it's 2 between negative 1 and 0. See, this part here was concave down. This is concave up. And it's a parabola, so the second derivative here is always negative 2. Second derivative over here is always plus 2. So it's discontinuous. F twiddle double prime is discontinuous. Well, that means that F twiddle hat must go as 1 over n cubed. That means that BN goes as 1 over n cubed. That means that CN goes as 1 over n cubed. Now, if you actually do the integrals, you discover that CN is 8 over n cubed pi cubed for n odd and 0 for n even. But the upshot is that it's decaying like 1 over n cubed. You only need a handful of terms to get a very good approximation to this function. Okay, so the rules of thumb for how fast a sine Fourier series converges is you have to notice that the even derivatives of f of x will always flip sine at 0 and at L. If you have a function at 0, you mirror it. And the same thing goes for the second derivative and for the fourth derivative and the sixth derivative and so on. So if somewhere the actual derivative jumped, well, then, of course, if the kth derivative jumps, then you expect to go as 1 over n to the k plus 1. But if you don't have jumps in the derivatives, if you just have behavior at the endpoints, if the second derivative at the endpoint is not 0, then when you extend it, it'll jump. If the second derivative at L isn't 0, when you extend it, it will jump. If either this even derivative is non-zero or this even derivative is non-zero, then you can expect Cn to go as 1 over n to 1 more power than that. Odd derivatives have no effect. They extend across the mirror image with no problem at all. So for example, if you had the function f of x equals 1, well, the value is non-zero at 0 and L, and when you extend it, you have the function 1, you do the mirroring, you get the function negative 1, and you get a jump at 0. And because of that jump, the Fourier coefficients go as 1 over n. If you have a tent function, then you have the derivative is discontinuous at this point in the middle, so you don't even care what happens at the endpoints. And finally, our parabola. And with a parabola, it went as 1/n³.